I imagine that that day started off just like any other day for Simon and Andrew and James and John. They probably got up while it was still dark, maybe grabbed a piece of bread as they put on their tunic and tied a belt around their waist, walked however far it was they had to walk on roads they could walk on in the dark, knowing just where they went every day to go fishing. They had their nets then and were fishing. Simon and Andrew, James and John were mending their nets. Maybe it wasn't a good day for catching fish, and so while the others were trying, they decided to sit and do what they were doing. Just a regular old day, fishermen doing fishermen things, and then Jesus comes along. We talk about the disciples a lot, and we know that there were like the Pharisees who had status, and we say that the disciples were just fishermen. We say that, don't we? They were just fishermen, as if fishermen didn't really count all that much. On Thursday, I had opportunity with Barb to volunteer at iDignity event that was put on. Once a month, iDignity of Orange County gathers together people from Social Security Administration and the FLOBUS, which is the Florida License on Wheels, which can print out licenses right in front of you. They get people there that can print out Florida birth certificates, and they have a whole bunch of people trained to help you apply for a Social Security card and also get an out-of-state birth certificate applied for. And they bring all of these people together because there are a whole bunch of people, more than you can imagine, that do not have ID. And when I say people, I'm talking about homeless people and people that are otherwise living pretty close to the edge. And you don't realize how often we need ID. You just kind of take for granted that you have it with you. But applying for a job or cashing a check, there's all kinds of times we have to prove who we are. And so these churches that started iDignity like a decade ago thought they would do this once, get all the people ID, and they'd be done. I think we had over 200 people show up on Thursday when they do this every single month. Now, it was my first time, and so they gave me a different color name tag to, I think, help all the rest of the volunteers know that you don't know what you're doing. So I had on my t-shirt that they gave you, and then I got my name tag on, it says Derek. And as I was walking around, the people that are coming there don't necessarily know that. So they would come up and they'd ask me a question, and I would say, I'm just a volunteer. I don't know, right? Because then I was freeing myself from having to know too much, which I didn't really know. That was true, but I would say I'm just a volunteer. And it got me to thinking how often we as people use that word just for lots of different reasons. Sometimes we use it like I did last week to sort of beg off responsibility because we don't know and we don't want too much to be saddled on us. So we limit ourselves and say, oh, I'm just a volunteer. But other times I think we have received that label. Like, not claimed it for ourselves, but received it for ourselves to believe that somehow what we do isn't as important as what some other people do. So when we talk about the disciples, maybe they said, well, I'm just a fisherman. The Pharisees are the ones that do the important things. And in our culture, you know, we can say, I'm just a teacher, or I'm just a custodian, or I'm just a farmer. And we start to think that maybe other people are the ones that do the important things. And more so, we can receive it, but we can also apply that label to other people and say, oh, well, that person's just a volunteer, or just here for a little bit. I was mindful as I was learning how to be a pastor, I'm still learning how to be a pastor, but in the early days of that, going to the hospital, there's so many people who work at a hospital. There's the CEO, and then there's doctors, and there's nurses, and there's laboratory people, and there's pulmonary people, and then there's people that come in and sweep up the room. And I wonder if you went down those levels, how many of those people would say, oh, I just cleaned the room. Well, if they don't clean the room, people get sick, right? But we get to this place where you say, oh, well, I'm just a nurse. The doctor's the one that has to sign those things. And I don't know if the CEO says, I'm just the CEO. Maybe. I'm just the CEO. The board tells me what to do. But we, I think, get into this place as a culture where we either limit ourselves by claiming that, or that limit gets placed upon us to where we think we're just something, not a full human being, not fully capable of bringing value into the world. And that's why I think this story from Mark is so important. When you read the Bible, there's lots of people that don't get names. They'll say, there was a man, and he came to Jesus. There was a leper that came to Jesus. And you could easily say, well, it was just a guy that came, because we don't know their names. There was a woman. We don't know her name. But in this story, we know their names. They are Simon and Andrew and James and John. The story doesn't tell us that Jesus said their names, just said, come follow me, but Jesus calls them by name. Jesus is constantly saying their names, right? And so they are actual people there, but there's something amazing that happens in this story that's easy to kind of pass by. They are just fishermen, the way we would say that. But when Jesus says, I'm going to make you fish for people, he is completely changing their identity. Not changing their label, right? They're still fishermen, but he's teaching them to fish in a different way and redefining what it means for them to be fishermen. They are no longer just fishermen. They become fishermen who are going out into the world to bring this kingdom to people and bring them grace and love and mercy and hope and forgiveness and all of this good news that Jesus is preaching. So this little bit of saying, I'm going to make you fish for people, and this calling them by name is a hugely transformational thing. It's changing their identity, even if they are still understanding themselves as fishermen. It's like Jesus is saying to them, you're not just fishermen. I'm going to teach you how to fish for people. I'm going to change you into someone different and change your purpose and your meaning and everything you do in your life. Now later in the Gospel of John, we hear that they kind of go back to fishing again because they're still fishermen after Jesus is gone. But we all are sitting here because they got out of that, and I'm guessing most of them probably fished a lot for the rest of their lives. They probably went back to that even as they went about doing the rest of this work they were called to do. But Jesus changed who they were, and that change has two aspects to it that we hear in this story. One, it's immediate. And as we work through this Gospel of Mark through this year, we will hear that word a lot, immediately. So there's an urgency to this transformation. And the other thing is we get the sense that it's total. They just drop everything and go. So it's urgent, it's immediate, and it's all-encompassing, this transformation that Jesus works in them and changing them from just fishermen into a whole different kind of person. And I think much of that starts with them being called by name. Simon, Andrew, James, John, you are no longer just fishermen. You are now going to fish for people. That urgency that Jesus brings with the gospel, I think it comes in the all-encompassing nature of it because the brokenness that we experience in the world is urgent and it is all-encompassing. And it's easy for those of us who are relatively comfortable to sort of forget about that urgency sometimes. One of my colleagues has been inviting me to go to this iDignity stuff for quite a while, but it hadn't worked itself up to an urgency or an immediacy quite yet until last week I finally was able to go. And when I got there, what I realized is that many, many people live their life in an urgent and immediate and all-encompassing brokenness every day. I had a conversation with a young dad that was carrying his child, and as we were moving between the points of my role, we were just chatting a bit, and he said, I've saved a lot of money being homeless. I've saved a lot of money being homeless. Can you imagine saying that while you're carrying a little baby around? I mean, that just tells you how urgent and immediate that situation was. And I had some other conversations with other people. You have no idea how it is to live in those stressful places and to live amidst all of that struggle. And here they are in this place. And what are they looking for? They're looking for an ID. Now, how many of you have been frustrated by how many documents you have to bring to get your license? Imagine if you live on the street and your backpack gets stolen and you now do not have any proof of address because you don't have an address. You don't have your social security card anymore and you don't have your birth certificate. You can't get ID with all those things. Without the ID, there's so many things in our world to get closed off to you. So they come to this place where all of these volunteers gather, and they come to this place hoping that they can walk out of there that day making some progress toward getting an ID. And some of them were super grateful at the end of the day to say, ha-ha, I can go look for a job today because I now have this because of what you all have done. But this is what had the biggest impact on me. I had my name tag on, and it said Derek. And almost every one of the people that were there trying to get ID would call me by name. They would say, Derek, can you help me? And the other volunteers all had name tags on, so they would come and everybody was getting called by name. Now they had a training in the morning, and the training talked all about why we do this and all these other things, but one thing they didn't talk about in the training, they didn't tell us you should call these people that are there to get ID by name, that you should speak their name and, you know, sort of identify them as a human being. But somehow you picked up on that because everyone was doing that. They have a little card they give them to tell, help the volunteers know where they need to go, and it's got their name on it. And pretty soon you're Paul and Sean, and you're just talking to them and calling them by name. But the other thing that was lingering with me the whole time was a memorial service that was held downtown Orlando towards the end of December. I think December 21st is the longest night of the year. And so they have this memorial service as close to December 24th as they can, because if you're homeless, being outside on the longest night in the cold part of the year is kind of a hard place to be. And they've had this memorial service for homeless people for a number of years now. There were 91 names that they read aloud that morning in that service. Not a single they've had in the past, like a Jane Doe or a John Doe, they don't know who they are. But this year they said, I think it's 7 years running, they've known who they all are because of the work that iDignity does in the food pantry churches downtown, and trying to name these people by name so that they have some sense that they are seen and known as human beings. And so during that service, they had each name was read. Someone would light a candle and take it up and stand up in the chancel area until there were 91 people standing up there representing each of these homeless people that had died homeless that year. But each of them was named. So last Thursday, as we're going through this process of trying to give them ID, which is calling them by name, and we were doing that by naming their names, and they were naming our names, I think we were really living in this immediate space of calling people by name and saying, you know what? You're not just a homeless person. You're a human being. I saw one guy, he had a little tattoo of some musical notes. So I just said, are you a musician? And he just lit up and said, yes. And I said, what do you play? And he said, well, I play the piano, and I play, well, I can play anything. He's got a reed in it, he said. And I said, what's your favorite? He said, well, baritone saxophone. Now, 4 years ago, I had no idea what that was. But now that I have kids that are musicians. So we had this great conversation. And for me, that was just a little holy moment of what it happens when he can call me by name and I can call him by name. And here we are in this transformational space of understanding that we're not just anything. We are all full, beloved children of God. So my hope when we hear this story today is to be reminded that each of us has been called by name. And when we get baptized, we call out our names, right? We say, I baptize you, and we say that name. And when we get to a funeral and we commend this person to God, we say their name, we speak each other's names. And so my hope is that we can hear this story and know that we have been called by name, and we are not just anything. So if you are a fisher person, right? Jesus says, you're not just a fish person. I'm going to teach you how to fish for people. I can imagine him saying, oh, you're not just an accountant. I'm going to teach you how to account for people. You're not just a farmer. I'm going to teach you how to farm for people. You're not just a custodian. I'm going to teach you how to take care of a place and to take care of people. So that we hear this and understand that Jesus speaks each of our names and calls each of us into this place of being a full human being that isn't just anything. Now that memorial service had one part that really touched me deeply. They had a time for eulogies for people that work downtown with homeless people all the time to get up and share some stories about some people. And one guy stood up and he talked a little bit, and then he said, you know what you ought to do? You ought to carry around some granola bars and waters in the trunk of your car. Not unlike our Love and Above box bags we put together. And he said, if you see somebody that's homeless, stop and share some of those things with them. And then he said, but I challenge you to do this. Ask them what their name is. And tell them your name. And he said, you need to do that because it makes it more personal. They're not just a homeless person that you're giving something to. They're now a person with a name. And you are a person with a name to them. It's a human connection that is immediate. It's right in that moment. And it starts to lead us toward a more all-encompassing sense of how it is that God's grace lives in our lives. And I was across town two weeks later, and I didn't have a glove box bag with me, but there was a guy walking between the lanes of traffic, and I gave him a couple dollars, and I never had done this. I said, what's your name? Guess what his name was? Yeah. Andrew. Simon, Andrew, James, and John. Oh. And I had my collar on, so then he said, I'm trying to get back to church. And I was like, oh. But I told him my name, and we just had this little moment, right? So for all of his walking up and down that day, I don't know how many people asked him his name, and I don't know how much he feels like he's just a guy on the street begging, our hearts a little bit to let some of this grace in that we have not earned. There's nothing we've done to do it. God calls us, gives us this gift of life, and invites us to share it with others, and may we be blessed to do that. Amen.